this seems scripted. It's like they did write, they wrote in the Taylor Swift arc to the season.
Yeah.
So that's your
NFL's R-worded. We've said it.
Yeah. They're R-worded big time. Wait, no, you want to know which R-worded, right?
That's your NFL and Taylor Swift update.
Rigged.
Trailer time.
Rigged.
All right, Lights, Camera, Barstool. It is movie and TV news time. Jeff D. Lowe, Ken Jack, Gooch coming at you here. Beginning of October, have a bunch of trailers, some big Marvel news, some comic book news, a lot to get to. Let's kick it off with
Hugh Jackman and Ryan Reynolds
and Sean Levy.
They're
we talk about that.
What a fucking crew.
I'm hearing rumors that the only reason Taylor Swift is dating Travis Kelce is to create a bunch of hoopla and distraction so she can make Big Fat Liar 2 with Sean Levy. He's doing Deadpool 3, which a lot of people online were like, he did all the Deadpools. No, he didn't. He's doing Deadpool 3. He obviously directed many movies over the years, including, you know, the reboot of a lot of Steve Martin movies, the Pink Panther, Cheaper by the Dozen, the reboot. Did he do
Bringing Down the House?
I don't think so. But he also directed the All Too Well short film for Taylor Swift, which I did not realize that she had a direct connection to him. Yeah, he did Night at Museums, Date Night, Real Steel, Ken Jack, which I know you love.
I like Real Steel. I'm a Real Steel head.
Did the internship with Owen Wilson. Yeah, Free Guy. Yeah,
good movie.
He was in the box with Hugh Jackman and
there's Ryan something, Rose. By the way, that we have to bring up. So something that happens is that me and Jeff get PR emails, like companies will send us shit when they have like shit they want to talk about and everything like that, and they want us to talk about. One of the ones we got, I think, on my last count, I got two. There might have been more. You might have gotten more. Two emails from people, PR agencies promoting Jake from State Farm being at the game with Donna Kelce. They're like, check out who's here. It's Jake from State Farm. Guess what? Fuck Jake from State Farm, the least charismatic mascot in all of the brand in the entirety of the world. This guy, we talked about this in our group chat too. This Jake from State Farm, he is standing in the shoes of the actual Jake from State Farm who made the commercial famous. And what has this Jake from State Farm brought to the table?
Nothing.
He has zero charisma. He does nothing for the actual brand of State Farm, nothing for the character of Jake. He's just there. He's no longer a funny bit. He's just a dude that's there that adds nothing. At least like Flo from Progressive tries. You know what I mean? Like there's like an attempt at a bit there.
I would take Jamie from State Farm over. Jamie from Progressive over.
I would take Chris Paul there. Take fucking J.K. Simmons at what's not State Farm. What's the other one? Farmers? I don't know. Like
get all those guys. Farmers. Back. Yeah. I didn't want to tweet it because like it seems so. I was like, whatever. Who cares? But we did get those emails, and everyone's like, "Yo, Ryan Reynolds! Like, how sick it, this all the whole thing was set up by his like marketing agency." It was a whole. The whole thing was a stunt. He knew he was going to the game. He got Jake from State Farm. It's just like it's so
ugly. It's gross.
Just not genuine whatsoever. It was like
inorganic as hell.
Gross.
Fucking Jake from State Farm, ain't ya?
Jake from State Farm, FTW.
Yeah. No, that was the thing. It was that was Ryan Reynolds' quote tweet. He goes, "Jake from State Farm, FTW." It's like, who the fuck has said FTW in the last
five? The replies are like, he's always so locked in. Like, I mean, this is his bit. It's his thing. Yeah. He's doing this. I did tweet. It's very funny watching NBC lean so heavy into using Taylor Swift for ratings, which they're clearly trying to get a female audience. So to an extent, like it's justified, but it is funny. It's nothing has come close to outrating Sunday Night Football in like 15 years.
Oh yeah. They don't need
like
it.
They're clearly trying to capture a demo they don't have, which I don't like. It's the only demo they don't like really have, I guess. But it's like nothing competes with Sunday Night Football. So the idea they're like, just keep on throttling AFV, throttle America's Funny Thumb videos. We'll beat them by 800 times the view. Yeah, it's just like, it's pretty funny.
Yeah, and then they rigged the game for the Chiefs, which we all watched and we're discussing that. Mm-hmm. And then they put in their bio. NFL bio. Chiefs are 2-0 with
It is like it's funny because the NFL did lean into like this whole scripted thing this year with their ad campaign. Like it is scripted, but like this is, I'm not saying it is, but it is like the funniest fucking, this seems scripted. It's like they did write, they wrote in the Taylor Swift arc to the season. So that's
NFL's R-worded. We've said it.
Yeah, they're R-worded big time. Wait, no, you don't. You want to know which are awarded, right?
That's your NFL and Taylor Swift update.
Rigged.
Trailer time.
Rigged.
Top news of the week for me, because I thought this trailer was awesome. The Argyle trailer from Matthew Vaughn, who, what would you say his most recognizable project is?
He's involved in so many great movies, but like as far as his, like Kingsman,
I think Kingsman is,
I would
like,
say Kingsman.
Kingsman directed First Class, X-Men, yeah. Great movie. Directed
by a lot, I would imagine, but
that almost gets drowned out because of the franchise. Like it's like,
yeah,
he doesn't have his own stamp on that as much as he does with Kingsman.
He has this new movie coming out, Argyle, which looks, the trailer was awesome. It's that style. It's that the music, the everything. Yeah. He also produced Rocket Man.
Snatch.
Stars Henry Cavill as Argyle. Bryce Dallas Howard, Sam Rockwell, who I actually, by the way, Sam Rockwell's in the trailer, but he's got like long hair and like a mustache in the beginning. I thought it was Steve Zahn initially.
Yeah. Righteous Gemstones. Yeah.
I thought it was Steve Zahn. Bryan Cranston, Catherine O'Hara, Dua Lipa in a massive role, it seems. Ariana DeBose, John Cena, Sam Jackson, Sophia Boutella. So a lot of people from his Kingsman stuff. Ellie Conway, played by Bryce Dallas Howard, an introverted spy novelist who seldom leaves her home, is drawn into the real world of espionage when the plots of her books get a little too close to the activities of a sinister underground syndicate. When Aiden, played by Sam Rockwell, a spy, shows up to save her, he says, from being kidnapped or killed, or both, Ellie and her beloved cat Alfie are plunged into a covert world where nothing and no one is what it seems. So it seems though she's writing these books and they're predicting and foretelling what happens, like in actual. So it's so like the Henry Cavill, John Cena, and Dua Lipa stuff are like fake in her books, but then there actually is like a real version of it. It's cool. It's oddly similar to a very recent movie that came out with who was in it? Channing Tatum and Brad Pitt.
Oh, The Lost City of D.
Sandra Bullock, The Lost City of D. Where she like wrote stuff that was actually real.
Yeah.
Oddly similar, but like this is it's that they're definitely different, but it had like a weird similar vibe. This trailer looked awesome. I'm very excited for this.
It's funny because we're gonna have that same ethic issue with the next movie that trailer we talk about too, with like a recent movie kind of having the same ish premise. But yeah, no, I agree. Like I think Matthew Vaughn, when you look at his filmography, not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, like especially the follow-up Kingsman movies. That first one is so great, cool and innovative. The next two kind of stunk. But like he knows stylized action and he knows good music. Like we were just humming Elvis right before we started. Cause like that, their use of, what do you call it? Their twist.
Yeah.
On was it Suspicious Minds, right? Just fucking,
we can go on together.
Like, dun, 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 dun. Like it's just cool. And he knows stylized action. He knows good music. I like all the actors involved. Like everything should work. It's like the premise is where it's going to really be a hit or miss. Like this could either be really dumb, really lost in the sauce, really stupid, or like they find a way to work it and make it just kind of seem like a fun, goofy movie. And I prefer it to be that. Dua Lipa, hello, once again. Henry Cavill, his hair is a little weird, but like, because you know how hot he is, but then they give him that square ass.
Intentional. They uglified him.
Yeah, they had to ugly him up a little bit, I guess. But like that haircut's a little wonky. Would have preferred it to be more, you know, Agent August Walker from Mission Impossible Fallout. But still, but yeah, I mean, I'm in. I want it to be good. I have a cautious optimism for it.
Yeah, he looks like he's looking for Kakarot.
Yeah, he does. He's very Vegeta-ish.
Yeah, no, I agree. The premise is definitely like one of those ones where you're like, this could be great, but there is a very real chance this could be a fucking mess of a disaster. I did think it was very interesting that they just laid it out on the table in the first trailer, like, hey, this part of the movie, not real. Like, or at least it seems to be not real.
They do tease the real Argyle. We don't know who it is, or we don't see who it actually is.
The cat.
That was my least favorite part of the trailer, when they're like, huh? Huh? I'm just like looking at the camera at the very end.
CGI cat was so dumb.
CGI cat's kind of stupid, but I could see myself absolutely loving that. Yeah. Like that stupid stuff. Sam Rockwell. I mean, what's left to say? Has he ever been like anything less than enjoyable in a role? He's just always extremely charming. I love him. And Bryce Dallas Howard as a lead, like in our own movie.
Yeah.
She kind of towards those later Jurassic World movies, she was kind of like the character you kind of liked the most, it felt like. I don't know. I'm excited for this. February doesn't give me a lot of hope, but past few years, the early year releases have been better. Maybe this will continue that trend.
Yeah, I'm not overly worried about this, though. Like, all of his original first offs have been good. I think Stardust may not be that great. Stardust with Claire Danes is like whatever, but it's not like horrendous. Layer Cake is awesome with great Daniel Craig.
Great movie.
Kick-Ass is one of the best film movies ever made. Yeah. First Class is great. Kingsman, the first Kingsman, is really good. The second two is where it kind of got convoluted like too much. So like, I think that's my only, like, if that's the only concern, obviously he's been a producer on so many good movies. He didn't do the second Kick-Ass. Right.
You didn't like the second Kingsman when they had the CGI fingering shot?
Yeah, that was.
We talked about that quite a bit on this podcast. The second Kingsman
cool was, by the way, we didn't get a chance to mention that, but he was a really cool interview. Very candid about the Fantastic Four disaster and like the kind of issue that you go through with the studioification of a movie. So cool dude in that regard.
I forgot Henry Cavill's in Stardust too.
Oh, wow. He has a weird early history. It's like Immortals.
Yes.
He's like up in there and out of nowhere. Mm-hmm. It's bizarro.
No, I'm excited for it. I have good faith in it. You're right. Like The Gentleman came out in February of that year. It was the last movie before COVID.
Really good movie.
I have good faith in it. So that's Argyle. Hits theaters February 2024. Marvel will begin meeting with writers to talk about X-Men this fall. Try to have a team in place to start in 2024. That's still like 3 or 4 years out. So like that, we're not getting anything soon for that whatsoever, but I guess that's cool to hear. Gets me a little excited. Yeah, what are they going to do? I don't think anyone has any clue what they're going
to
do.
I don't want them to go in-house is the thing. They've been doing in-house a lot for the last few years. Like,
yeah.
Which I like. I mean, we love Waldron here, but going back to that, well, I think they just need some new blood in the water.
They do. They need new styles. They need new vibe. They need new visions.
Because their stuff is shit.
There we go. Boom. Roasted. Fuck you, Feige. Come on the pod.
It's weird thing about X-Men is like, X-Men is like far from like the movies that exist right now, far from the most consistent property. But like, I have a lot of nostalgia for the first few X-Men movies.
Oh,
and like, I really like First Class, Days of Future Past. So like, it's not like, oh, you can't like fuck this up. But also, it's not like they have a ton of room where it's like, oh, you can right all these wrongs made by previous X-Men movie. Like, yeah, Dark Phoenix and Apocalypse stunk, but like, there's good movies there, and they're going to have to like redo or kind of like revamp this in a whole new way that gives us something to look forward to. Cause I feel like we're at the stage where like, if they fuck up anymore, it's not like it's over. There's still like $1 billion movies and all that shit. But like, it's like the trust is already on like very, very thin ice. And I feel like that would be the tipping point where people are like, why am I going to bother going to a Marvel movie anymore?
They're aware, and like there's COVID definitely in the strike has impacted Fantastic Four for sure. But I think I would assume, this is an educated guess, that there was a pretty astute awareness of wanting to give as much time as possible between the most recent Fantastic Fours and the new Fantastic Four. I think they took this with a slower speed rather intentionally.
Yeah.
I think like, obviously Marvel's had some issues in the last couple years and it's not been very consistent and not as good as the first run, but I still think there's an awareness there. They know what they're doing, at least in like the structure when they release stuff. That's why they've waited so long. So I wouldn't be shocked if they wait a while again with X-Men, because people do say it seems like it's going to be 4 years until we see the first movie. So, though, they are going to be in Deadpool. So that's already a pretty open secret that they will be in Deadpool. Though the older X-Men, it seems like most of them will probably die or be killed off. So we'll see.
Dang.
Directed by Sean Levy. Yeah.
No more Sabretooth.
Martin, old Marty Scorsese says studios, they're unwilling to invest in non-franchise film and express concerns about the long-term health of the industry. He is doing essentially all of the press for, he is doing all of the press for Killers of the Flower Moon. So he's playing the hits right now, but he's not wrong. It is a big problem. And I'm also glad, he definitely mentioned superhero films as well too, but I think in general, the key word here is franchise films. It's not just Marvel. It's not like it is. It's other things too. Like, comic movies are not going away. It's just not happening. And like, they're going to invest in those. I have said it for years in this pod. We've all said it, is that it's the other shit that worries me. It's the, you know, let's keep making more Space Jam movie. It's stuff like that. It's the other franchise stuff where it's like, we got to do another Home Alone. It's like, no. It's like, no. No, we don't. We don't need to do. It's like, you could probably say the same about comic movies, but at this point, it's so far gone. It's like, I don't even think that's like the crux of the issue. It's the other franchise stuff.
You know what I mean? Like, you want those other movies to get made. Like, guess what? The studios still need money. And those rake in the money alongside horror movies more than anything else. So, kind of just need it.
Yeah, it's just funny to see the reaction to his comments every single time he has to do one of these press tours or anything. Because he really isn't saying anything wrong, like, or that anyone should disagree with. Like, it's just not controversial. And then people, like, will take it as, oh, Marty Scorsese says there should never be another comic book movie made ever again. Mm. All this stuff. It's like, no, he just wants, like, the smaller movies to have their chance. And something I didn't know that I figured out through this press tour, he hasn't done a studio film since Shutter Island, I think was the last title he did, through a studio. Like, he has made his movies and gotten funding for them and then sold them to the studios, but he hasn't had a studio. He hasn't had studio oversight while making a movie in over a decade, which is nuts.
Because he's the boss, baby. That's why he's Marty. I do like the idea of like turn of the 80s into the 90s, or maybe a little bit into the 90s. Like Richard Donner's like, I can't get a fucking superhero movie made because all the studios want gangster movies these days. That we're going to fucking can't get funding for a single Superman 8 project going.
Did you know that?
Did you know
that Marty almost did the Dick Tracy movie?
What was that?
Did you know that Martin Scorsese almost did the Dick Tracy movie? The Warren Beatty Dick Tracy movie?
He'd probably be great if I would get something like that.
It would have been way different, obviously. Our good friend James, Mr. Sunday Movies from the Weekly Planet, they did a video on the Dick Tracy movie. I had no idea about that. I had no clue that. Also, did you know that Warren Beatty... It's another thing I didn't learn. It's a good video. They released it on Mr. Sunday Movies. That Warren Beatty still owns the rights to Dick Tracy.
How?
And that...
God, he's so vain.
Because he apparently went on Turner Classic Movies. I think he went on TC, and he did an interview. He did an interview with in character as Dick Tracy, and that helped hold in the right. You know how it's like Fantastic Four. They had to make more Fantastic Four to keep the rights, and so he did an interview as Dick Tracy, and then as recent as like last December or something, I forget the exact date, he did another one. An interview series in character as Dick Tracy, but this time he like was also out of character for part of it. So like that's how he's kept the rights to Dick Tracy for all these years.
Oh, he had a lawsuit in 2011 for the rights too.
Crazy. Just crazy. I was like, what the fuck? But that obviously that Dick Tracy movie would have been significantly different had it had Scorsese behind it. Damn. So that's the news on Marty. First trailer for May December, starring Natalie Portman and Julianne Moore. 20 years after their notorious tabloid romance gripped the nation, a married couple buckles under pressure when an actress arrives to do research for a film about their past. Hits Netflix on December 1st. Thoughts on May December?
Yeah, the first feature film written and directed by blogger Jerry Thornton. Very excited for this. Julianne Moore and Natalie Portman, two of the best actresses in the game. Like, what more do you need to say than yes? I'm totally in. And I'm always like actors playing actors. I always think it's a cool experiment for them. And I don't think, has Natalie Portman done that before? I don't think so, right?
Has she played an actor?
She's played herself when doing the Natalie Portman rap on Lonely Island.
She was a stage performer in Black Swan.
Yeah, I don't know. But I always like the experiment for actors being able to do that. So I'm in. I'm very in on this.
Yeah, no, the initial reactions on this one, which is kind of surprising, it being like a Netflix movie, they just typically don't get that kind of reaction, has been overwhelmingly positive. Mm-hmm. Apparently, yeah, Natalie Portman, always great, but has turned in a hell of a performance. Julianne Moore, you can always count on her, especially in Kingsman 2.
It's true. Kingsman the 2. Meat grinder.
And Todd Haynes, a smaller director, but, you know, people seem to really love his work.
Carol. Carol got a lot of hype, obviously. Some nominations for Cate Blanchett. It'll be Dark Waters recently with Mark Ruffalo. No, looks solid. Those are great actors to have in a Netflix movie. Todd Haynes is a solid director. Also, that weird Bob Dylan movie, too.
Oh, yeah. Wasn't Cate Blanchett in that as well?
She was in that. You're right.
Yeah. Forgot about that. That was a weird one.
Very, very strange movie. And then the other movie, first trailer for Sam Esmail's Leave the World Behind, starring Mahershala Ali, Julia Roberts, Ethan Hawke. A family vacation on Long Island is interrupted by two strangers bearing news of a blackout. As the threat grows, both families must decide how to best survive the potential crisis, all while grappling with their own place in this collapsing world. December 8th on Netflix, another Netflix movie.
Yeah, so this one is just Knock at the Cabin, but better. That it is like it feels very similar in concept and execution, except for the whole Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse sort of bit that was going on there. I mean, the crew is incredible.
Yeah, I mean,
just Mahershala and Ethan Hawke alone. I mean,
with us, I mean, I know you guys aren't the biggest Mr. Robot people, but
I like Mr. Robot.
Yeah, this feels very much in the same vein as Mr. Robot 2, where it's like a cyber thriller,
cyber attack.
Which is a tough genre to do. We've seen it time and time again. People just cannot figure out like the cyber shit. Like every time someone tries to do cyber terrorism, it just comes off so inauthentic or like just jumbled and doesn't really connect.
They hacked into the module and now all the planes are going down. Yeah, it's like, okay. It's like,
oh, that doesn't. What was the Chris Hemsworth one?
Black Hat. Yeah, yeah, Michael Mann, baby.
Right, Black Hat. Oh.
But to the mainframe.
It's like, well, that's we also we're reviewing the movie The Creator this week.
And yes, dude. When they every single time in The Creator when they say hacker, I'm just like, what the fuck are you talking about? Like, it's so vague.
Some of the dialogue, especially for Allison Janney's character in The Creator,
hack like, everything,
hack it all.
It's like hack it all. So fucking stupid.
No, yeah. We gotta wait on that.
That's a great point.
Yeah, I mean it looks good. It looks like it's shot well. Has some cool vibes. So yeah, you bring up the Mr. Robot thing. Great actors, actresses. So that's on Netflix in December. So that's two pretty solid looking Netflix releases coming out in December. All right, that's it for movie and TV news here on YouTube. Make sure to like and subscribe to the channel, helps us out a ton, and like the video, give it a thumbs up, and let us know below the project or thing you're most excited about from news today. I mean, mine definitely be Argyle. That's it for Ken, Jack, and Gooch. I'm Jeff DeLo. We'll talk to you next time.